we're going to start with something known as multi-threading in Java. So multi-threading in Java will focus on concurrent programming, right? So concurrent programming is the real term. It means that at the same instance of time, your program will be able to do multiple tasks. Let's take an example. For instance, you're going to open a Google Chrome. Google Chrome is a software, it's an application. You open a tab and you type www.facebook.com. So you are surfing Facebook somehow. You open one more tab now. So at that instant, you are typing the Twitter and you are able to access your Twitter account. So two different things are happening at the same time. Now that is known as concurrency or parallel programming, right? So here once again, if you are going to surf your media player, let's say you have opened your media player, at one instance of time, you are listening to the song in the background and you will be also able to download the songs. You'll be able to manage your, you know, kind of playlist, etc., etc. at the same instant of time when your song is being played. This is again kind of parallel programming. So let's try to understand what exactly are the objectives for the day. So we'll understand what is multi-threading in Java. Then we'll understand what's a thread, why we need it. There are two APIs. One is the thread class. Another one is the runnable as an interface. So we'll discuss them. And thereafter, we'll see some various methods and finally the states of a thread. Then we'll move on to synchronization and thread interaction. Right. So this is going to be the whole content for the day. So I'm going to take you guys to one of the illustrations so that we can realize what is a thread. So consider that I got my operating system, right? So this is my OS. So typically when you talk of your OS, our JVM is pre-installed. So our JVM will manage all the Java applications. So if your Java application is running, the management will happen by your JVM, right? So there is a layer over here somewhere, right? You can see that this guy is your Java virtual machine. Now, if a Java application is going to run, it will be managed by your JVM, right? So whenever your Java app will be executed, there will be something known as a process which will be created, right? So we call that JVM will form a process. Whenever your application will be in execution phase, you will say it's a process. So technically, you say your application is in a process, or your application is a process when it's in execution state. As a normal user, what I am going to say is my application is running. As a technical guy, I will say it's a process. For an instance, I will say this QuickTime player is running, it's a process. Paint is running, it's a process. Eclipse is running, it's a process. FileZilla is running, it's a process. So since I can't see these apps running, so I will say they are the apps now. So a running instance of an application is nothing, it's a process. So technically we need to come up and understand what's a process, right? First of all, a running instance of your application is nothing, it's a process. Now what happens? In the process, there exists one guy known as main thread. So there is one guy known as main thread. Now what this main thread is all about? Main thread will do some jobs for you, right? So there are some jobs which the main thread will perform. Some jobs can take more time, some jobs can take less time, some jobs can take very, very less time, right? And some can take a longer duration. Main thread is capable of performing some jobs, right? So you can say, this guy is my job number one, and this guy is the job number n. So J1 to JN, these are the jobs which will be executed by my main thread. Now main thread will execute all these jobs one by one. It means J1 will be executed, then J2, then J3, then J4, and finally to the JN. Makes a sense? So you got a running instance of your application known as a process. Process will have a main thread. Main thread will perform some jobs. jobs are performed or executed in a sequence. So sequentially we are going to execute the jobs now. So J1 to JN, it won't happen that JN job is executed before the J1 job. So it has to be in a sequence. Now we mention all these jobs of the main thread in the main method. So you say jobs of main thread are written in the main method of our program. So your program's main method will define the jobs of your main thread, right? So whatever your main thread is going to execute, whatever your main thread is going to execute, that is nothing but that is your jobs of the main thread. Makes the sense now? So whatever you write in the main method, they are nothing but they are the jobs of the, and they will be executed in a sequence, one after the other. This makes a sense now. It means that on my OS level, there can be multi-processing. There can be various processes which my JVM is running or my OS is running. For example, as of now, your OS is running this Finder app, Messages app, some Chrome. Here you go with Sublime Text, then FileZilla. So on OS level, I am able to say multiple apps are running together. So technically what I will say, multiple processes. So I can say my OS is capable of performing multi-processing. So OS performs multi-processing now, right? OS is going to perform multi-processing. Now, what is the problem? The problem lies over here. Let's see this. This guy is one blocking job. It's a blocker job, right? Why? Because the underlying jobs, they will not be executed until and unless this job is not executed fully. Let's try to understand it with one example. So there is an event at home. Let's say there is wedding at home. There's a marriage function, wedding, event at home. So father has the responsibility to finalize a few of the jobs over here. So the first thing which he has to do is he has to finalize the wedding venue where the wedding has to take place. Second thing, he has to finalize the DJ. Third thing, he has to finalize the caterer. So there are sequences, right, which he has to do. So one day, fine morning, he started doing the job and he thought like, let's come up with three of the guys all together in a single day. So in the morning, I will go to the wedding venue. In the afternoon, I will go to a DJ guy, and in the evening, I will go to a caterer. He decides that I will do these tasks. These three jobs I have to perform today. So when he went in the morning, he found that it took me a very long time and I got free in the evening just finalizing the wedding venue itself. It means that when one certain task or a job is taking a lot of time, the underlying jobs, they are blocked. Let's take now one more example. We have a test, we have an exam. We have to prepare for it. And now you got various subjects which you need to prepare. Right? You know that one subject, if I am starting, this will take up a lot of time and underlying subjects preparation, that will be blocked. Makes a sense? Even for a single subject, you have one chapter which will take a lot of time. So till this chapter is not finished, my underlying chapters will be suffering. So there comes the multi-threading. You will call your friend. Bhai, I am done with my chapter number 1. You please take care of chapter number 2. And specially the bhai bhan system will come only with the closest of the roll numbers. Right? So just in case, I'm just kidding. So the other way is like, the father was supposed to prepare for the events. Right? He was unable to prepare it. What he can do? He can offload the responsibility to the other guy, his elder son, right, or elder daughter, or his brother or his sister, whatever, right? So he's gonna offload the jobs to the other family members so that the same day DJ can be finalized, caterer can be finalized, and wedding venue can be finalized. Now this is known as parallel programming. So what we are supposed to do? Let's first of all try to understand this problem statement in the program. Let's try to code this and understand what's a thread and what is meant by this guy main thread. So let's come back and let's say a new Java project. So I'm going to name this as session number 15. And let's write one new Java class. So this goes like my threads demo under the package com.auribises with the main method. So I got this program known as threads demo. Let's do a finish. So coming back now, I said CISO main started. And the last instruction goes like main finished. Now this guy main is going to have a for loop. Int I equals to 1, I less than equal to 10, and I plus plus. So you will say CISO, let's say I is, or let's try to just print main thread. And I will just put an I. Now when you run the code over here, the first thing which we need to observe is everything happens in a sequence. Makes sense now? So this is my job number one. Main started is my job number one. I can say the entire for loop is job number two. And I can say main started is my, main finished is my job number. So as of now, I got three jobs, J1, J2 and J3. J2 is a time consuming job. Makes sense? Let's say if this job is going to be less than equal to some big number. So this much time it's gonna be consumed by my, you know, program so that this can be finished off. So it's a time consuming job over here. So this J2 is time consuming. So I'm just keeping it number 10. I'm saying that J2 can be time consuming job, right? It means the below instructions will be blocked until unless this J2 is finished. Now what I am going to do, I am going to introduce one class. I am going to say this is one, you can say task. The class name is task, right? And here I got a function which says that perform task, and this task can be some task, right? To present this task, I am going to put a for loop, and I will say this guy is task, right? So what I am doing is I am going to create an object of task. Tref is a new task, and you say tref dot perform the task. Now what has happened? We got various jobs which are supposed to be performed by the main method. So whatever the jobs you are writing in the main method, they are nothing but they are representing the jobs of the main thread. So whatever you are writing in the main method, they are nothing but they are the jobs represented by the main, right? So now, as of now, we were considering main is one function which is going to execute the, which is going to begin the execution of the program. Now you should understand that main is representing the jobs of main thread, and main thread is the guy which is created by the process. So every process has only one main thread, right? Now, J1 will take some time. J2 over here is one task which is supposed to be performed. It means that control will now jump from the main into some other block that will be executed, and then the control will come back. So this is my job one. So let's try to define the jobs. J1. And I am considering that this is my J2, this is my J3, and this one goes like your J4. What is the problem over here? The first problem is, if your J2 is going to get executed, the below underlying J3 and J4 will be blocked until and unless J2 is not executed. Makes sense? So you run the code, you will find the same story. That everything happens in a sequence now. Main started, the task is performed. After the task is performed, your main's loop is executed. And after the main's loop is executed, main is finishing. So there is something known as sequence, which is not breaking, and everything is coming one after the other. What I want? I want that this is a time consuming task. This is a time consuming task. So there are two tasks now. Task J2, job J2, and job J3. So task and job, I'm trying to use the same synonyms, okay? So job or a task, I'm trying to use the same synonym as of now. So in my J2, if J2 is going to get performed, your J3 is totally blocked. I want these two jobs should be performing parallelly. I want them to be executed parallelly. That is my requirement now. So what I want my J2 and J3 to be executed parallelly. I want to offload the task of J2 to someone else now. As of now, the responsibility of executing the J2 goes with your main thread. So what I am going to do now, I am going to say, let's come in our process and let's create one more thread. And let's try to say, so this guy's second thread over here is nothing, it's a user thread. Right, it's a worker thread, it's a child thread, you can name it anything. It's one separate thread. It's a child thread, it's a worker thread, it's a user thread, which has to perform something. So what I will do now, the task which was taking time, right? So this task or this job was taking time. Let's give it to the child thread. Let's give it to the child thread, right? And at the same time, we will add a very small task over here, a very small job over here. So this job is basically to make sure that you will start or create a different thread. So at this job over here, I will highlight the job. So this job over here, right, for the main thread will be the one which will create or start a new child thread. And child thread will execute that job for us. So the bigger job is executed by now, child thread. So what happened now? What happened now? So I got two threads in my same process. One is the main, other one is the child. Terminology is child thread or user thread or worker thread, whatever the name you want to use. But once you started with your child thread, now your JVM is gonna perform time slicing. What is meant by time slicing? When you are going to study, when you are going to study for your exams, you are the JVM. Let's consider that now. Alright, so I'm just considering that. You are the JVM. So there are two subjects which you want to prepare. You will perform time slicing, switching. Right? So let's study this subject, this important topic, and let's come to the other subject, and let's now study the other topic. So what will happen now? Your JVM will give some time to the child thread and some time to the main thread. So let's say if we got a child thread with multiple jobs over here. So let's say this guy is having some more jobs to be executed, right? So some jobs of the child thread will be executed, some jobs of the main thread. So your JVM is going to perform time slicing now. So what will happen? Both the things, they will appear to be working in the same direction, as in parallelly or concurrently. Let's try to understand how. So consider that you got your CPU, right, with a frequency of 2 gigahertz. And now when you want to come up with a time to execute some instruction, it can be 1 by 2. That comes out to be 0.5 nanoseconds. You reciprocate the frequency, right, and you get the time interval. You just take one very basic example, right? So it can be any gigahertz of frequency. Processor can be any gigahertz. You reciprocate your frequency, you'll get the time. So it's half of a nanosecond. Just imagine, 1 second versus half of a nanosecond. Nano is 10 to the power minus 9. Let's say that this is going to be the processing speed, right? Processing speed. So it means that if my instructions are supposed to be executed, in 1 second, there can be n number of instructions which can be executed. For us, we will get a feel that multiple operations are happening parallelly. But at the end of the day, what is happening? Everything is executed in a sequence, but time slicing is happening. Right? So you get a time slicing or a switching of the intervals. So what I am trying to say, once again, let us review. The first thing which we understood was, you got a blocker job in the main thread. When you got a blocker job in the main thread, the underlying jobs will not be executed. So here comes one requirement to create one child thread. Many a times, a blocker job will be a job which will be sending a request to the server and waiting for the response to come back. For example, in Facebook, if I want to view a video, if I want to watch a video, it shouldn't be a case that until unless video is not loaded, you cannot do anything else. What happens? Video keeps on loading, images they keep on loading, and you keep on scrolling. Makes a sense, right? So here you don't wait, right? So multiple jobs are happening parallelly for you. So a blocker job will be typically a job which will be more or less concerned with your network. So it's gonna be a network request, right? You're gonna request to the server and you are waiting for the response to come. So such a request response, you offload to the child thread, right? So this question can come up. We can wait, no problem. In the main thread, let's try to wait. If you are going to wait in the main thread, right? So it's gonna be a very bad user experience because user is waiting, and finally OS will say that your application is not responding. Would you like to wait or would you like to kill it? Makes a sense. So in case your application's main thread is blocked, your OS will figure it out and OS will give a message to the user, sir, this application is not performing, it's really bad, please kill it and try again. I think all of you would have seen these messages, especially in Windows it will come, not responding, right? So here what we are going to do, so in order to escape from this situation, we will offload the heavier jobs to the child threads, right? Now let us see how we can come up with the child threads. Okay, so what is the thread? I think this is clear to everyone. So in order to define a thread, I will just say it's an execution context. It means that it's gonna execute the series of jobs in a sequence, right? So you can write execute the jobs in a sequence. So gonna execute the jobs in a sequence now. Then what is next? When you say that thread is an execution context, it's gonna execute the jobs in a sequence. Why we need a thread, right? Why we need a thread? Because we want to offload the task to child thread so that main thread shall work freely. You don't want to burden the main thread. If you burden the main thread, your OS will give a message, right? Yet your application is not responding. Make sure that you shouldn't be landing into these situations. So majorly, in order to perform network requests, right? So whenever you are going to perform some network requests, so there you need to have your child threads. Let us see how we can create a thread. To create a thread, you need to either use a thread class or a runnable interface, right? So what I am going to do now, I am just going to say, this was my class task, right? So I am going to comment this task. Let's not comment it. Let's try to create one more task, right? So I am going to name it like my task, and my task is going to be extends thread. Now thread is a class in Java, which is a predefined class. It's available in java.lang package. So thread is available in java.lang package. You need not to import it. When you say extend thread, you need to override one method. So this method comes like public void run. So if you can see a green color triangle over here, the indication which is showing that you have overrided one method. So there is a function known as run which you need to override. If you can closely observe, task and thread, they are very much similar. Task and my task, they are quite similar. Task is not inheriting anything, whereas my task extends the thread. Now whatever the jobs were supposed to be performed by the task, they were mentioned in the perform task method, whereas here you have mentioned it in the run method. Come down, let's replace the J2 with my task. So my task is a thread now. My task, let's say mref is a new my task, and you say mref dot start. Now start is a method which will internally call the run method. So when you are using multi-threading technique, what you need to do, you need to call the start method. Let's try to run the code now and see what's the difference. All right, so let me just maximize it. So what difference can you observe now? I can see that main started, then few instructions of your for loop from the main thread were executed, then all the instructions from your child thread, that's like your my task, and then again main thread. Now you try to run the code again, you got a very different output. You try to run it again, what is happening? Time slicing. Sometimes the time is given to the main thread and sometimes to the child thread. So two different guys are actually executed in a parallel operation. It seems like it is executed parallelly, but in reality it is time. So you cannot predict the output of the threads. If you say that, sir, I want to predict the output of the thread, sir, you cannot do so. Why? Because threads, they're gonna be executed by the virtual machine, right? And it's gonna perform some time slicing. And when it performs time slicing, you don't know when it is supposed to give the time to what thread. So the outputs will be always unpredictable. If you can see now, multiple executions will result in different outputs altogether, because time slicing is happening. My task, when I was executing this task and not the thread, right? So when I was executing the task and not the thread, you can see that every time you are getting the same output, not the multi-threaded approach, right? So you execute n number of times, you get the same output. With the help of your thread, you can see that multiple operations are now getting performed parallelly or concurrently, right? So every time you'll get a different kind of an example, different kind of an outcome, right? In the execution environment, you can see different outputs, right, guys? Are we now clear what is a thread? So a thread in Java is a class. So there's a class called thread, and there is a function called run, and there is one more function called start. So start will internally call the run method, right? So there is one class thread, and there is one interface runnable as well. So you got one interface runnable which has a method called run. Please have a look, guys. And your predefined class, it's gonna implement runnable. So in java.lang package, to be specific, what I got one interface runnable, one method called run. This implementation of runnable interface is done by my threads class. So my threads class will have a run method as well as a start method. It is also having a start method. Internally, you are executing the run method. It means your class can be a my thread which will extend thread. So you need to override your run method. and later you just create the object and you say empty ref dot start. Makes a sense? So you need to say empty ref dot start over here. So the moment you say start, start will internally call run. Now why we are not directly calling the start method, I mean the run method? So there is a reason to it now. So the reason is we got states of a thread. So there is something known as state management, right? There is something known as state management. So we'll understand that in a very short while, but you must have a clear opinion on this, that my thread, if it is supposed to run, we should not call the run method directly. We need to call the start method. Start method will internally call the run method. Why it is happening? Because of the states of a thread, right? So we'll understand what are the states of a thread. So let's say now in my program, I got one my task, which is extending thread. Let's also try to create one more task and let's rename this and let's name this guy as your task. This guy will not extend thread, but this guy will say implements runnable. Everything else is same. Everything else is same, right? So this is my task. Let's try to change this my task over here. And this is your task, right? So let's try to say this is your task. Correct? Can you see any difference in my task and your task? Only one difference. Extends thread, implements, runnable. Rest everything is same. So it means that for the developer, it's very basic and very simple. You create a class, extend thread and mention the run method and write your instructions over there. And you are done. So having a thread means you are going to run parallelly with the main thread. That's one good news. Right? So your task over here is going to implement runnable now. So come down. If you want, you can say, have a look guys. You can say runnable R is a new your task. Is this statement correct? When I say runnable R is a new your task, is it clear to everyone? What is this? It's a runtime polymorphism, right? So it's an RTP instruction. It's a polymorphic instruction, right? Reference variable of the interface is pointing to the object of child, which is implementing it, right? Now you come down and you say a normal thread class. You say thread, you say thref is a new thread and you pass the guy R. So you created the object of the thread class, but you have passed internally reference of your task object, right? And then you now say thref dot start. So in case you come up with the runnables, let's say you wanna say implements runnable, right? So there's a different way how you create a thread, right? To create a thread, you first of all write a runtime polymorphic statement. Runnable R is a new your task, and then you create the object of thread and you pass the reference over there. Alright, so what I can do, I can also try to write this instruction, copy this new your task and just mention it over here. So rather than mentioning it in this way, you can write it in a single go. Choice is yours now, right? So either you write it in this way or you write it in this way. Choice is yours. Now let's try to run the program and see what will happen. Now I'm having just a moment. Just remove this. Let's try to run the code. I got three guys running parallelly, right? Main thread, my task, your task. Run the code now and you see the series of your program, again time sliced, and the sequence is coming up as in mixed. So makes a sense? Time slicing is happening or not, guys? Are we able to understand? And the things are working parallelly. Some time is given to the my task, some time to the your task, and some time to the main thread. Threads are really, really easy to understand. They are not a complicated situation. If you can see, if you got this basic fundamental, you are done with the threads now. Are we good to go? So to create the threads, I got two different ways. The first way is you got a class which can be extended. You got an interface which can be implemented. Now, why we got an interface? There has to be a reason that why we got two different concepts. Let's say you got a class A, and thereafter you got a class B which is already extending A. Now you cannot do multiple inheritance on A. You cannot say that if your class A extends A comma thread and you come up with some run method over here, right? You cannot come up like this. It's an error. So rather than saying extending of thread, right, what you can do, you can say implements runnable. So if you are already doing an extension operation, if you are already extending, then you can go with the implements runnable. So why runnables are required? Runnable is required in case you are already having an inheritance situation, because Java will not support multiple inheritance. Very, very important and a crucial question in the interviews even. What is the difference between runnable and thread? So runnable is an interface, thread is a class. You cannot do multiple inheritance in Java. You cannot say extends B comma thread. It's not allowed. But you can say extends B implements runnable. Now that's the solution which is given to you. So you're good to go, guys. Great. So whenever you run the code, you find the different outputs every time. Now what I am going to introduce is, I am going to introduce a function called sleep. There's a guy called sleep, right? So let's see how it happens. In my main thread, in my J3 over here, so I'll say thread dot sleep for 1000 milliseconds. Thread dot sleep for 1000 milliseconds. Milliseconds are 10 to the power minus 3, so it comes out to be 1 second. And now you can see one compiler is giving us an error, right? Because of the checked exception. So compiler will say that please surround this guy with the try catch block, right? So this is nothing but this is your checked exception, which a compiler is giving it that you must put it in a try catch block. The same thread.sleep I am going to put in my your task as well as in my task. Now let's run the code and see what will happen. Have a look, guys. Task by task execution, job by job execution is happening over here, right? Let's rerun the code and let's try to understand it once again. So once again, one guy has to sleep. Right, so the other guy will be executed by the JVM. Now if you manipulate the intervals, right, so let's say that this guy is 500 and this guy is 1500 and this guy is 1000, right? So now let us try to run the code over here. Now you can observe the output is a bit aligned and we can understand it how the output is coming. So when the one thread sleeps, it means that it is going to be in a pause state for some time interval. Means it is blocked. It is not going to perform anything. When you make your thread to sleep, it means it will not do anything for that particular time. And the underlying instructions in that thread will be blocked. If you say thread.sleep, the underlying instructions will automatically block, right? So when this thread is sleeping, JVM will execute the other thread. And when the other thread will sleep, it will execute the third thread. Till it executes the third thread, the first thread which was on a sleep state, it will come back and it's going to execute it. So this whole cycle management is happening for us, right? So now you can see, you got my task to be executed in a two way because it was 500 milliseconds. So 1500 guy was the last one to be executed your task. It's taking 1.5 seconds. So you can put some timestamps by the thread.sleep method call, right? So you can make your thread to be suspended temporarily for some time interval. That's like your sleep method. All right. So now anyone having any query over here? What are threads? What is multiple threading? or how you are having a concurrent programming. Are we clear, guys? Yeah, babe. This is one syntactical approach, right? क्या चीज ये ऊपर वाला समझ में आ गया. आर यू क्लियर विद दिस पार्ट? सेम पार्ट ना. व्हाट इज आर कंटेनिंग? लेट्स टेक वेरी बेसिक मैथमेटिक्स सिचुएशन, राइट? व्हाट इज आर? हाँ, आर इज अ रेफरेंस वेरिएबल विच इज होल्डिंग द एड्रेस ऑफ योर टास्क. यानी कि न्यू योर टास्क, वट एवर इट गेव इन रिटर्न, इट इज कैप्चर्ड इन आर, एंड देन सेम आर गाय वाज पास्ड इन द थ्रेड. So I'm just writing the new your task. What new your task will return? It will return me the reference, and you are directly passing it. Kis thread mein? Why we are passing it here? It's a syntax. Why you put the semicolon in the end? It's a syntax. Why you write string str is a new string and you mention hello in it? It's a syntax of using a string. Right, it's a syntax. So it's a predefined API. So the way they have created it, we are using it. Clear, right? You are clear, ma'am? All right, anyone else, guys, with the queries? Yes, sir. Yeah, sleep is a method. Sleep is a static method of the thread class. For temporarily suspending the thread for 1 millisecond. So for 1 millisecond, this loop will be waiting, right? After again 1 month. So this, let's say that you are going to execute only one thread, right? So I will not say start on these two threads. It means that I have only one guy which will be working. It's the main thread, right? Let's try to run the code now. Did we understand the meaning of thread now, thread dot sleep? So after every 1 second, getting an output. Good to go. So let's say you want to create a countdown timer. That goes like your homework part now. You need to write a countdown timer. Right? So countdown timer has to be constructed as a part of your homework. It's a very long sequence somehow. Don't worry. So what's going to happen when your threads will be executed, right? So they will start from zero and they will end it, right? So we got states of a thread. Let's understand. We got states of a thread. So when you create a new thread, the state itself is a new. Then the state goes into runnable. The thread is able to run. Then the state goes, it's like as in start. Or you can say the state is running. So we got states of a thread now. And eventually your thread will be finished. So in between, this thread can be blocked, or it can wait, or it can be suspended. Let's see these say states of a thread, right? So what are the states of a thread? You just say thread dot state dot. Blocked is a state, new is a state, runnable is a state, terminated is a state, timed waiting. These are the states of a thread, right? So thread has a life cycle now. So we got a life cycle of a thread. So when you create a thread, it's like a new thread. When you call the start method, it's gonna move into a state called runnable. And then when the start method will internally call the run method, it is running. The state changes into running. So calling the start method does not mean that your thread will start. Calling the start method shifts the state of a new thread into the runnable, right? And then your thread will be in execution phase. We say thread is running, and when every job will be executed by my thread, it will be terminated. Let's say you are putting the sleep, it's a timed waiting. We can also make it an infinite wait. We'll see it in our upcoming slides how we can do that, right? So as of now, these are the states of a thread. So you can just access the states of a thread over here by having a thread.state dot all the states. Let us also try to figure out what can be the different threads having their names, right? Let's see. So what I'm going to do in the end over here, before the main finishes, I will say CISO, my task name plus empty ref dot mref dot get the name. Your task name, so you got thref dot name, and similarly main name thread dot current thread dot get the name. Now let's see what we are doing. I am getting the name of my task, your task, and the main thread itself. So for my task, I am calling the get name method. For your task also, I am calling the get name method. But for your main thread, we are saying thread dot current thread. Current thread will give me the reference of the main thread, and then I am calling the get name method. Now you run the code over here and let's try to understand what is the outcome for the names. Alright, if you can see now, so it says that my task name is thread 0, your task name is thread 1, and main ka name is main. So these are some internal names which are given automatically. So let's say if I want to give the names to my thread, how I will do that? So I am going to say mref dot set the name. It goes like my thread. Very easy. You say thref dot set the name your thread, or you just say my task, right? So that was the real name, my task, and you say your task. And for the main, if you want to change the name, you say thread dot current thread dot set the name. Let's say Charlie. Right? Run the code now. So any time in your program, if you want to have the names to your thread, so that if you want some logics to be implemented and you want to recognize your threads by name in your programs, you can do so. Here you are, my task, your task, and the guy, Charlie. So my main is Charlie now. Good to go, guys. So very easy, right? Setting the thread and setting the name and getting the name. So if you want, what you can do, in my task, I can create a constructor. So this one constructor which I have created, I am going to take the input as name, and you say super name. The constructor is going to be in the my task. And you are taking the input as name and you are passing it to the super class. So here in my task, so you say the name of my task is Ben, right? So rather than setting the name over here, you can pass the name in the constructor as well. Let's see the output now. So now you can see your task is Ben, correct? Sorry, my task is Ben, right? So we change the name of the my task. So either you call the setName method or you create the constructor. Choice is yours. These are the two different options to do so. We are now going to retrieve the priority of the thread, right? So I'm going to say priority. Let us understand what is the meaning of priority. So the way you got get name, in a similar way I am calling the method get priority. So everyone knows what's a priority, right? So if you are into exams, the priority of mathematics will be higher, or any challenging subject will be higher over the others. So you can now see for my task, your task, and main, there's a single value of priority that's like 5. We got a 5, right? Same priority. So let's try to change the priority of them. Now what I am going to do is, before you start the threads, I am going to change the priority. I will say mref dot set the priority to be thread dot max priority, which is the value 10. Maximum priority means the value 10. And then you say thref dot set the priority to be thread dot minimum priority. So minimum priority over here is going to be the value 1. And you say thread dot current thread dot set the priority thread dot normal priority, which is a value 5. It means by default, if you don't give the priority, it is 5 for everyone. And you can set the priorities as per your choice. Now we are getting a feel that mref is having the highest priority. It means it will be executed above all. Correct? You are getting this feel now, right? We are setting the priorities. You run the code now and you feel that, and you will see that it is executing the way it was executed previously, because we have kept a sleep method call. So priority is not coming into the action. But let's try to understand. First of all, priorities are changed now. Max is 10, minimum is 1, and normal is 5. What I am going to do now, I am going to comment this sleep method call, and I will try to see, is there any change? Let's try to comment the sleep. So here we are. So now the sleep is not there, right? So you run the code over here, you get the output in a single go. You see that my task is prioritized now somehow. But one more thing. Your task and main thread, so 1 and 5. You try to run again, and you can see that my task is prioritized, but now it is not. So it means that there is no effect. Every time you are trying to execute the code, it's a separate output. Right? So it means it is working in the same order the way it was supposed to be. Setting of priority is a request. What it is? It is a request. I am requesting, in case you have less memory resources, or in case, dear JVM, you are busy. So there is a guy called executor in the JVM. So executor will execute the threads now. Right? So who will execute the threads? Executor will execute the threads. So executor will ensure that in case I have less memory resources and this guy needs to be prioritized, so I will ensure that. But only when I have less resources. So it's a kind of a request. It's not a command. It's not a command. It's a request. Dear executor of JVM, so please execute the threads with some priority in case you have less memory resources available. Right? So it's a request. It's not a command. Then there is one more guy. So this guy goes like yield. So the way you got your thread having the setting of priority, you can say mref dot yield. So yield is again a request. Yield is again a request which says that don't execute my tasks, execute the tasks of the others. So since the priority is a request, similarly yield is a request which says that, sir, don't worry about me. You give priority to the other threads. Execute me in the end. Are we good to go with this? Great. Now, the moment you start the mref, I will say mref dot join. I'm going to say mref dot join. Let's see what is this mref dot join. Click over here and say surround with try catch. Now you run the code over here. What you see is that my task is executed. You run the code again. You see my task execution. Run the code again. Again my task. Again my task. My task. Join is a command. Join is a command which you need to put immediately after the start of the thread. So the moment you said mref.start, immediately after the start, I have called the method. Join is a command which will ensure that only your my task will be executed and all the other threads will wait. Right? So sleep is also a command. Join is also a command. Yield is a request. Setting of priority is again a request. So if you are supposed to call the join method, whenever you call the join method, right, you need to make sure that it is called immediately after the start method. Makes a sense, guys? Right? So great. So this goes like your threading part. So anyone having any query over here? So these were the thread methods and various states of a thread. So till here, anyone having any query? Whatever we did, we saw some multi-threading techniques coming into the action. Are we all good? Great, guys.